all professionals, including the politicians. Before we formally take over to the session, we also like to know that it's very difficult for any person in life either to be successful in the profession or in the politics. It's very, very difficult to maintain both the things in the right frame of things. So before we formally go, we would just like to have the insight how you have been able to maintain that balance of two balls together. You're not able to make the ball fall and both the balls are doing very well. And both facets, that is as a life as a politician, as well as a rather another facet of yours is that you have been closely associated with Punjab University, being in the Senate and Syndicate, and also Dean of the Punjab University. So all these three things you are maintaining. Fourthly, once we find the traces in the Facebook, etc., you're very closely knitted to your family, which is also a very good sign for all of us to see as to how that balance is maintained. Just before we go online on the actual topics, just a few insights on that aspect, how one should learn this art.
Thank you, Vikas. Bahut dhanyawad, tumne bahut short period mein kafi questions put kiye hain. Main do teen choti choti baatein kehna chahta hu. 96 में जब मैं लोकसभा में इलेक्ट होके गया था और 13 दिन की अटल बिहारी वाजपेयी जी की सरकार बनी थी, तो ओथ लेने के बाद नेक्स्ट डे पार्लियामेंट्री पार्टी की मीटिंग थी जिसमें वाजपेयी जी ने अपना एड्रेस दिया, उन्होंने अपना भाषण दिया, तो उनके दो सेंटेंस मुझे अभी तक याद हैं। उन्होंने कहा कि देखिए, जो 24 घंटे हैं वो राष्ट्रपति के भी वही हैं जो पीएम के हैं, वो एक सीनियर मोस्ट एडवोकेट के भी वही हैं जो चीफ जस्टिस के हैं, जो वकील के हैं, जो क्लर्क के हैं। इसलिए ये आप पे डिपेंड करता है कि आप अपना टाइम कैसे मैनेज करते हैं। ऐसा नहीं है कि जो लोग काम कर रहे हैं उनके 24 घंटे 48 घंटे के होते हैं और आपके 24 घंटे 12 घंटे के होते हैं। नंबर एक, इसलिए अपना टाइम मैनेज करिए, एंड इफ यू मैनेज योर टाइम, नो सीरियस प्रॉब्लम। सेकंडली, दे सेड मूव इन ए प्लान्ड मैनर। आपने क्या करना है, कब करना है, उसकी मैनेजमेंट है। मान लो आपने कहीं जाना है और आपको पता है कि आपके घर से वहां का 1 घंटे का रास्ता है, तो अगर आप अपने समय से 1 घंटा पहले चलोगे तो वहां पहुंचोगे। अगर आपने जाना 11 बजे और घर से पौने 11 चलोगे, यू विल बी लेट। तो इसलिए ये छोटी-छोटी चीजें जो मैं पॉइंट आउट कर रहा हूँ, ये अपनी अल्टीमेटली मैनेजमेंट का इशू है। थर्डली, जो मैं बहुत बार बात कहता हूँ, जो हमारा इथोस भी मानता है, मेहनत सब करते हैं, हार्डवर्क सब करते हैं, कोई अपनी अपनी क्षमता के अनुसार कोई कमी उसमें रखता नहीं है। बट गॉड इज काइंड टू ऑल, बट मे बी अ लिटल मोर काइंड टू अदर्स। गुरबाणी में आता है ना कि कौन नानक तू जागे अरदास हमारी, जियो सपन तेरा, कौन नानक सब तेरी वडियाई, कोई नौ न जाने मेरा। इट्स ऑल ग्रेस ऑफ गॉड। गॉड हैज बीन वेरी काइंड टू मी। आई हैव बीन फुली, आई एम ए सेटिस्फाइड पर्सन, फुली अकॉर्डिंग टू माई सेल्फ, सक्सेसफुल इन लाइफ ऑल्सो, प्रोफेशन ऑल्सो, पोलिटिकल लाइफ ऑल्सो। सो इट्स ऑल ग्रेस ऑफ गॉड, आई कैन से। आई डोंट टेक एनी क्रेडिट फॉर दैट। ग्रेस ऑफ गॉड, लव एंड अफेक्शन ऑफ द पीपल, फ्रेंड्स एंड एडमायरर्स।
सो बट बी दैट एज इट मे, everybody wants to be good, but to maintain the balance between that question still remains unanswered. How you have maintained the balance of being a successful politician, successful lawyer, successful family man, and more so in academics also?
See,
just a short wrap up.
You have to divide your time. You have to adjust your time. When you are in a court, you have to behave like a lawyer. When you are in a family, you have to behave like a father, brother, husband, and all that. When you are in public life, you have to behave like a political man. So it's ultimately adjustment of time, nothing else. If you just want to waste your time, you can do it. Keep on sleeping in the AC room and all that. But if you want to contribute in different fields, one has to be alert. मैं महाभारत में कर्ण और दुर्योधन का एक संवाद आता है। तो दुर्योधन से कर्ण ने सवाल किया कोई, तो उसके जवाब में कर्ण ने कहा कि देखिए, किसी भी भद्र पुरुष, महापुरुष, वीर, एक सक्सेसफुल आदमी की दो चीजें सबसे बड़ी दुश्मन है। उसने कहा क्या? उसने कहा एक आलस, लेजीनेस, और दूसरी लंबी नींद। उसने कहा दो उसके दुश्मन है। अगर इन दोनों से आदमी छुटकारा पाले और अपने काम में लगा रहे तो कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं, सक्सेस होती होती।
सो द पॉइंट इज वेल टेकन। आई आल्सो वांट टू ऐड वन थिंग। माय फादर व्हेन ही वाज अलाइव ही यूज्ड टू से, भूख, नींद और लड़ाई, जितनी चाहो उतनी बढ़ाई। सो ही सेड दैट इट इज ऑल अपॉन यू एज टू हाउ यू विल डू। सो it's 11:30. We always try to maintain the schedule. As you said, we more so once you are on the platform and you are saying that we should maintain the balance. So Beyond Law CLC is a group of professionals out in Chandigarh, and UILS Punjab University has tied up for holding different webinars during this lockdown period. Today is the 32nd webinar, wherein we have taken different facets, different aspects of law, which according to us were intriguing, and students, professors, as well as the lawyers, pan India, by everybody is appreciating that, and the fact that we are also going live in a large number of events, and it is being well taken. Today's topic, what we had taken is election law in India. And I can vouch upon that with all my experience of professional, as while we have been seeing you in the High Court, that in fact you are Tina. Tina means there is no other alternative when election law comes into being. The fact that you have represented Mr. Narendra Modi when his two elections have been challenged of Varanasi, you have represented Shri L.K. Advani, Shrimati Sushma Samraj, then Venkaiah Naidu, Navjot Sidhu, Vinod Khanna. So when the election law comes in India, and you have represented in different 15 high courts, that also only speaks the fact that you are master. I can safely say you are akin to Amitabh Bachchan of what is in film industry, or Sachin Tendulkar in cricket. In election law, if constitutional law is your forte, but super specialization is the election law. We just wanted to have then certain insights which we can learn within a 1 hour, though I know that 1 hour is very difficult for it to be summed up. So due to certain reasons, now we have left with the Q&A sessions and a chat box. We'll just ask you, and then we'll ask again, as per our normal routine, what is the wrap up and how one can become a good lawyer. Mr. Jain is a senior advocate, additional Solicitor General of India, former member Law Commission. He's also been the Dean of Punjab University Law Department and member of Senate and Syndicate. Therefore, it is quite apparent that he's not only closely associated with academics, politics, because he's been twice MP. He's an additional Solicitor General of India. It is one of the most sought after aspect which lawyer thinks that it should be in his career growth. Over to you, Mr. Jain, and thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vikas Chatrath, and your entire team for inviting me today to discuss with you various aspects of the election law in India. Since we have to conclude this within reasonable time, and the issue is also very vast, elections to parliament, assemblies, and all other institutions in the country is a very long issue. So I will try to give you brief points about the constitutional position, legal position, and the practical aspects also. And after that, I would like to give clarification in case you feel anything to be clarified or you want any question to be put. Now, straightway coming to the point, the Indian Constitution has visualized three-tier system for elections to various institutions in this country. As per the Constitution, first is the elections to municipalities, panchayats, gram panchayats, panchayat samiti, jila parishads, which we can call at the lower level, first level, local self-government, we call it. Second is the election to the state Vidhan Sabha assemblies, legislative councils. And third is the election to the parliament, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha. And above all, election to the office of the highest office, constitutional office of the President of India and the Vice President of India. So this is the three-tier system that has been adopted in the Indian Constitution. After the amendment, 73rd amendment of the Constitution, Article 253K, it provides for elections to the panchayats, and Article 243ZA, it applies to the elections to the municipalities, corporations, etc., etc. These elections are to be conducted by the state election commissions. We should be very clear about it. Elections to the municipality, panchayat, jila parishad, etc., are not conducted by the Election Commission of India. They are conducted by the state election commissions, which are constituted by the respective state governments. And the by and large, the Municipal Act, Gram Panchayat Act, now there are Punjab State Election Commission Act, Haryana State Election Commission Act, Corporation Act, etc. They are by and large the paramateria with the provisions of the Representation of People Act. So I will not be going in detail. So far as the elections to the municipalities, Gram Panchayat under Article 243 to 43 ZA are concerned, because they are basically governed by the election commission of the state. Now, so far as the election to the assemblies, there are two houses in certain states, assembly also, council also, then Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, president and vice president. These six elections are conducted by the Election Commission of India. The Article 324 of the Constitution of India gives powers to the Election Commission to hold elections to the assemblies, parliament, president and vice president of India. All powers have been given. And under Article 329, there are two clauses of 329. One, A, there is a bar. The finality of the delimitation, etc., laws is final. It cannot be challenged in any court of law. And the second part is, which is important from lawyer's point of view also, no challenge to any election, assembly, president, vice president, MP, Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha. No election can be challenged except by way of the legal provision prescribed by the parliament or the state assembly. So therefore, the writ jurisdiction, so far as the elections are concerned, ordinarily we hear the cases when arguments are made, no, you can't challenge the election by way of writ petition. This is Article 329B, which is only challenge to the election can be by way of the procedure prescribed by the state legislature. Now, Indian Parliament has any laws for conducting the elections as well as for disputing the elections of various institutions. There are three acts. One, the Representation of People's Act 1950. Another, same name, the Representation of People Act 1951. These are two acts, same name, the year is different. One is 50, another is 51. And there is the third act, the Presidential and Vice Presidential Election Act 1952. These are the three acts which basically govern the election to all these institutions which I have dealt with you. First, I will deal with the Representation of People Act 1950. Sometimes people confuse. Sometimes appear in courts and even judges sometimes are surprised that how can it be there are two acts with the same name. The Representation of People Act 1950 deals with the preparation of the electoral rolls, the validity of the electoral rolls, the staff, electoral officers, and all that. It deals only with that. And there are certain things which we must keep in mind about this act. The finality of the electoral rolls, the voter list, that is the job of the election commission and the authority under, which is final. Which is final. You must be hearing a case from Haryana. I will not name the person and the constituency. Somebody went to file the nomination paper. His name was not there in the voter list. Now, as per law, the returning officer, the election authorities have to go by the final of the electoral roll. Once the electoral roll is published, it is final. And so much is the strict of the law, from the date notification is issued for holding elections till the polling is complete, neither anybody's name can be included, nor his name can be deleted. Some election has been announced, the voter list, file edit and all that. From the date of issuance of the notification till the result is declared, nobody can either be added as a voter, and if somebody has died, he cannot be deleted. The electoral roll will remain this way. Second thing, some of the people are political activists. When you go for polls, polling is taking place, somebody's name is there, he's a voter in the voter list, but he may not be qualified, maybe less than 18 years of age, might have shifted from Chandigarh to Ambala or from Ambala to Karnal and all that. Friends, remember one thing, as per law, if your name is entered in the voter list, whether or not residing there, and if you want to be a voter, I'm repeating, you are less than 18 years of age, but by mistake your name has been included in the voter list, as per law, if your name is there in the voter list, you are entitled to cast your vote. Nobody can stop you from voting, whether you are qualified or not. So, mean thereby, in nutshell, if I may say, that the finality of the electoral roll is final. It cannot be a matter of dispute. If you are there, you are there. If you are not there, you are not there. This we ultimately keep in mind. Now, these are the, you must be a resident, ordinary resident has not been defined. You can be allowed as a vote one place. Now this voter identity card, etc. has come. I'm not going into all those things because general everybody. Now then the dispute. The parliament has enacted another act, which is called as the Representation of People Act 90. It's a very voluminous containing about 152. It deals with the election right from filing of the nomination till the result is declared. This act deals with the entire procedure to get a chance to go through this act. Sections 3, sections of 11B, it deals with the qualification and disqualifications as to who are the persons who are qualified and who persons who are not qualified to contest. Can be very interesting. See, on the hear news of any political person that this man has been convicted for any offense. Now, and he has been disqualified for contesting election for 6 years. This clause, if you read it, is very interesting. Suppose you are convicted for 6 years in a single case, and you are 6 years from contesting election. So this 6 years will not start on the day of conviction. You are convicted today. You are released from jail after 5 years or 6 years. So this 6 years will start from that date when you are released from the jail. So practically, if you are convicted, somebody has been convicted for 10 years or 5 years or 6 years, his disqualification period will be additionally 6 years more than the period of conviction when he's sentenced. Then if you have been convicted for disloyalty to the state, if you have been convicted for any electoral offense, for example, you indulge in bogus voting, many other things, booth capturing, then again you are disqualified for a contesting election. Now if somebody is dismissed from service from the government, okay, he wants to contest an election. As per these provisions, I am not going in detail, you will get a chance to read all those. If you want to contest election, you have been dismissed from government service, you have to apply to the election commission. And election commission will issue a certificate that you have not been dismissed from service because of either corruption or disloyalty to the state. If this certificate is not issued, you are not eligible to contest election, you are disqualified to contest election. You go through all these clauses, which are very interesting. Sometimes one is surprised also that how this law could be that strict, but it is there. Ordinarily, we go by the age and all that, whether he is 25 years of age or not, whether he is a voter or not. But there are 15, 16 such disqualifications which are there. If you are having a contract with the government, if you are having any share in any government concern, if you have certain dues, all these clauses are added there, which deals with the disqualification from contesting election. Now, election, act of election, I will skip at the moment for that purpose. The Representation of People Act, see to it that there are certain grounds on which election can be declared if you go to the court of law. Section 100 of the Representation of People Act, it prescribes all the grounds on which your election can be set aside. For example, you are underage. For example, I have not deposited.
Sir, sorry to bother you. Could you check it? Because I am receiving messages on my WhatsApp that your voice is cracking on that side.
What is lacking?
Voice. Sir, thodi fat rahi hai uski. Crack ho rahi hai.
Acha, I'll check out. Theek hai, dekhiye.
Sir, I will ask on the WhatsApp because we have disabled the chat.
Is it better now? Dekhiye, theek aa rahi
hai abhi. We have started the chat. I will just let you know.
Just find out. Should I continue?
So you can start. Meanwhile, I will receive the messages from the chat. I will let you know.
Section 100 of the Representation of People Act deal with the grounds on which election can be set aside. You are not qualified on the date of election. And all the qualifications, I may point out, as per Section 36, have to be seen when? On the date of nomination or election or oath or scrutiny. As per law, all the qualifications have to be seen on the date of scrutiny. If on the date of scrutiny, you have completed 25 years of age, you will be qualified. But if you have not, then you may be completing the age on the date of election. You are not qualified to contest the election. If you have some contract with any government agency, if you terminate it one day prior to the scrutiny, you are eligible to contest election. But if on day you are in position or office of profit, then you are not qualified to contest the election. So therefore, all the qualifications to be seen on the date of scrutiny, and 100 prescribes the grounds for which election can be set aside. Now, ordinarily in the parlance, we talk of Bhrasht Acharan, corrupt practices. Election law section 123 prohibits 10 corrupt practices which no candidate can resort to. And it's very interesting. They are bribery, undue influence, appeal in the name of religion, appeal to personal correct, propagation of sati, personal character assassination of your candidate, hiring of vehicles, incurring more expenditure, etc., etc. Now I'll explain to you. The election law expects every candidate to be very, very reasonable and fair as per law. For example, I am a candidate. I go to request a particular person for voting for me. If I just go and tell him that, look here, this is my party, this is my manifesto, I am contesting, we are vote for me. It's okay, no problem. No problem, I can vote. I can tell them that my party is promising this much, this much, this much. But if I say to him, that look here, I am a Jain, you are also a Jain, or I am a Punjabi, you are also a Punjabi, I am a Hindu, you are also a Hindu, or I am a Sikh, you are also a Sikh. So vote for me. This is prohibited by law. This falls under the category of the corrupt practice. If I tell him, I go further, step further, that look here, if you vote for me, I will make you a member of the corporation, or I will support you in the election of the bar, or I will give you this office and all that. It's a corrupt practice of bribery. Earlier was the undue influence. If I tell him that, look here, I'm asking you, if you don't vote for me, if you don't vote for me, God will get annoyed with you, you will get some divine displeasure. So all the corrupt practice. If I do something that, look here, we belong to a particular religion, other man is of a different religion, and if he is elected, then it can create problems for the people of our religion, it's also a corrupt practice. If I take voters in my own vehicles on the day of polling to the polling booth, it's also a corrupt practice. If I say something about the personal character of the other candidate, he is in the habit of drinking, he is not honest, he is something which deals with the personal contact, conduct, character, this is also a corrupt practice as per the law. And now, after many cases coming from different states, booth capturing has also been made a corrupt practice under the law. If you spend more amount than the prescribed, for example, you are entitled to spend 10 lakhs in an election, assembly election, 8 lakhs, 5 lakhs. If you spend more amount than that, even then it is a corrupt practice and your election can be censored. And if anybody is convicted by any court, high court, in these matters, because the elections petition of the MP, MLAs goes to the High Court, then as per Section A of the RPA Act, the person can be disqualified up to 6 years from contesting election. So these are the very, very, very small things which result in serious consequences. Taking the assistance from a public servant, you might recall Mrs. Indira Gandhi's case. In 1975, when her election Justice Jagmohan Lal Sinha, what was the allegation against her? Shri Yashpal Kapoor was her personal assistant who was a government servant. She took the assistance of that person going to the stage, for erecting the stage, for he accompanied her during the election campaign. And the Allahabad High Court said that since he's a public servant, maybe your PA, maybe your PS, but he's a public servant. And if you take assistance from a public servant, you are not qualified to contest election. Her election was set aside. You recall all that, 75, the constitutional crisis came. Then later on, the act was amended during emergency when it was provided that if any person takes the assistance of his PA, PS, security staff and all that, this will not deem to be a corrupt practice. This was amended at that time. So I'm telling you, these are the 10 things, corrupt practices, which are very, very serious in nature. And the intention, what is the intention? The intention is that the candidate should not hit below the belt. They should fight on policies, programs, and all that. Now, this is all about basically the basic, various provisions of law. Now, the trial of the election petition in the High Court. Section 80, 81, 82, 83, 86 onwards, these sections deal with the trial of the election petition. Now, this is very important, especially from the point of view. The election law is very, very technical. The election law is very, very strict. If you have to file an election petition, the limitation is 45 days. My friends, Limitation Act is not applicable to the election law. Limitation is not applicable. If it is 45 days, you have to file the petition within 45 days. You can't say that somebody has fallen ill, extend my limitation, or there were vacations and all. Two, the election petition must contain all material facts. This may not be available. This may not be the requirement. Other fields of law, you can amend your petition later on, you can add, you can put more material. The election law expects the election petition to contain all material facts on which you rely. And if you do not do that, then under Order 7, Rule CPC, 6, Rule 17, CPC, the plea can be struck off, the election petition can be dismissed. I will request, if you get time, to go through two basic judgments. 1986, Azhar Hussain versus late Shri Rajiv Gandhi, Madan Lal Dhartipakad versus late Shri Rajiv Gandhi. Both are 86 and 87, where the Supreme Court says that if you miss to plead even a single material fact, there is no cause of action. Petition should be and can be, must be dismissed in limine. So in case you have to get a chance to file a petition, be very careful about the drafting. CPC is applicable. And the other side, very important, I'm telling you, other side, the returned candidate has to be supplied a complete copy, page to page, line to line, word to word, same of the original petition. You can't say that the next exercise I will supply later. These 3 pages I will supply later. And if you don't do it on this ground alone, your election petition can be dismissed. My Siddharth, we are facing that in Gujarat High Court and in many other high courts we are watching. It's a very, and the point I'm telling you is, it is very technical law. And it's a complete code. If you get a chance to study the entire law, right from filing the nomination till the result is declared, everything is prescribed in this section. As per election law, no principles of fair play, equity, balance of convenience are applicable to the election law. Things have to be done as required by law. If you have to file your nomination by 3 p.m., if you file it at 2.60, it is valid. And if you file it at 3.01, it is invalid. And number of cases, I'll tell you the formalities. Now you have to file the affidavit also, giving all your details, giving all the properties, giving all the cases pending, charges framed, not framed, all those things in an affidavit with your nomination form. And now the law has come that if you leave that column blank, the returning officer can read your nomination papers. The law has been to that extent. So things have to be done as required by law. If you want to get more details, in 1982, there is a reported case, Jyoti Basu, who was the former Chief Minister of West Bengal, versus Devi Ghosh, Para 8, where Supreme Court has dealt in detail, saying that election law is a special law, it's a creation of the statute, it's no question of any fair play principles of balance of convenience, etc., etc. Things have to be done as required by law. Second point, under the Representation of People Act and the election laws, all authorities are supreme in their own field. For example, the validity of the nomination paper has to be decided by the returning officer. Overall control and superintendent is that of the election commission. But election commission cannot direct a returning officer to either reject or accept a nomination paper. He cannot do it. the validity of the vote has to be decided by the returning officer. Election commission cannot direct the returning officer to either reject or accept a vote. You must have read in the newspapers in Gujarat, last to last election, Rajya Sabha elections, then the election commission directed the returning officer to reject two ballot papers which were cast in favor of Mr. Balwant Rajput, who lost the election by a fraction of the vote. This is under challenge in the High Court. Election commission has no power. Similarly, if the returning officer accept or reject your nomination, election commission cannot direct the returning officer to accept or reject the nomination paper. But the powers of the election commission are also very wide. Nowadays, we all know after this corona, the Rajya Sabha elections were to take place on 26th of March. Now, since the corona came, social distancing came, so the election commission adjourned the polling to an indefinite date. We don't know up to what time the corona will continue. Because if you go for voting, social distancing will not be able to be maintained. You will come in touch with others. There will be many other things. Election commission can postpone the election. It has all the powers. And you might recall one example. In 1980, Shri Hemavati Nandan Bahugana was contesting election from Gadwal. Voting took place. There were allegations that they have voted and all that. The election commission decided to cancel the alliance, the entire polling in 1980, and the polling was held afresh. So before the result is declared, once the result is declared, election commission can't do anything. Returning officer can't do anything. But even the polling has taken place and the result has not been declared, the law gives power to the Election Commission of India to pass any order that it may deem fit under the law. Gadwal, I have told you, the returning officer, under various provisions, once he passes an order, he has no power to review his order. Sometimes he wrongly accepts a nomination. Sometimes he can wrongly reject a nomination paper. But once he has passed an order, he has no power to review any order passed by him. He cannot do that. In election law, after the counting, the final power vests with the returning officer. And it is he. You are saying something?
Sir, I think at your area, in and around 3-4 more sets are working. That is why sometimes the voice starts cracking. Just ask yours and Dheeraj to continue with the this thing.
Okay, I'll just find out.
And meanwhile, I've opened the for the first time in the group, we have opened that you can post the questions in the Beyond Law group, WhatsApp group.
I'll read
the questions from that. So I'm only saying that we have opened the question answer session on the WhatsApp. They can post it to me. Yes, sir.
I'll just conclude within 5-7 minutes.
No, sir, I'm not cutting it short. I'm only saying that the questions can be posted on the WhatsApp group. Yes, sir. Thank you.
I will like to have the questions because it is such a technical subject. There will be many clarifications needed on the various aspects.
Sir, definitely. But I have asked that they can post it on the WhatsApp chat book, chat group.
So technical is the election law. I will give you two examples. One of late Prime Minister Chaudhary Charan Singh, and another of Sardar Pratap Singh Kero. In 1962, from Patti constituency, Sardar Pratap Singh Kero was contesting election, and Mohan Singh Tud, who later became an MP also, he was contesting against him. And after the whole counting was over, it was found that Shri Mohan Singh Tud was leading by a margin of 14 votes. So the moment Akalis came to know that they have won the election and they have defeated the chief minister, without getting a formal certificate of election from the returning officer, they all came out of the hall raising slogan Jindabad, Bole Sonihal, jaisa hota hai celebration, wo karte hue bahar aa gaye. The Congressi people kept sitting in the counting hall. And then they were able to persuade the returning officer to take out a bundle of 50 ballots. At that time, it was ballot where you had to put your seal on the ballot box, ballot paper. And he declared 50 votes polled in favor of Mr. Tud. and declared Mr. Pratap Singh Kero elected to the Punjab Vidhan Sabha. There was a very interesting thing. The jaloos was that of the Akali Dal. Sorry, area mein zindabad aur narebaji wo ho rahi thi. And certificate was given to Mr. Pratap Singh Kero. Mr. Kero left the hall immediately, came to Chandigarh, and his election was challenged. But since there was nobody in the hall at that time who could give the evidence that look here, this was done, nothing could be done there. Second example, Chaudhary Charan Singh, after he remained the Prime Minister of India, he was earlier twice the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh and very prominent politician, MLA and all that. After he became the Prime Minister of India in 1980 Lok Sabha elections, he filed his nomination papers from Rohtak parliamentary constituency. And I don't know what was the reason, people say many things. He forgot to mention his age in the column of the age in the nomination paper. Could anybody dispute the age of Chaudhary Charan Singh? The man had been the Prime Minister, man had been the Chief Minister. Now, since he forgot to mention the age in his column, his nomination paper was rejected because that was a substantial defect. I'm pointing out all these things to you. Sometimes you see things, we take things so casually. In 2004 parliamentary elections, Mr. Raj Kumar filed nomination papers against Srimati Sushma Swaraj in Vidisha, Madhya Pradesh. Now, as per law, the form 13 A and B, which is a authorization letter for symbol, it has to be signed by the person in ink, not by the ball pen. Secondly, you have to submit the form in original to the returning officer. Now, when he was going to file his nomination paper, he sent somebody to get it photostat down. So instead of the original, he filed the photostat copy, which is in violation of the law. His nomination paper was rejected because he did not file the true copy. He filed only the photostat copy. I'm giving you all these examples just to point out how strict, how technical is the election law. So these are basic, broad things which I have told you about the election law. Now the next is the election to the President and Vice President of India and the Rajya Sabha. In the election to the President and the Vice President and Rajya Sabha, anti-defection law is not applicable. For the candidate of the President, Vice President and the Rajya Sabha, an MLA is free to vote for any person he may like. In the election of President and Vice President, he is not even supposed to show his vote. But in the case of Rajya Sabha, just to avoid the, what should I say, sale and purchase or all other illegal means, the MLAs of the political party have to just show their vote to the authorized representative of that party. But still he has the right to vote for any candidate he may like. And suppose he violates the whip. Party says vote for A. The MLA votes for part B. You may take action against, the party may take action against him under the disciplinary action, expel him from the party, not give him ticket next time. But on that ground, his membership cannot be challenged. Anti-defection law will not be applicable for elections to the President, Vice President and Rajya Sabha elections. And therefore, this is something surprising. Sometimes people feel that you are an MLA, you have to vote as per the wishes of the party in these elections. The intention was that the election to the highest constitutional authority, the President and Vice President, is so sacrosanct that the electors should be totally free to vote for any person they may like. Somebody can argue otherwise also. And keeping in view that intention, this has been prescribed. Now, I told you that in Rajya Sabha elections, a few days back, the polling was to take place 26th of March because of Corona, it has been adjourned indefinitely. During the last 50, 60 years, I don't remember any other such incident where because of such type of situation, elections had to be deferred. It was only in 15th May, when late Swargiya Rajiv Gandhiji was murdered, then the polling was adjourned for about 2-3 weeks because of the situation that arose in the country. Now, this is for the first time that the time limit prescribed by law has been violated. Corona has been able to challenge the entire election law, get the polling postponed to an indefinite period. Otherwise, the time was fixed. Nomination within such and such time, polling such and such time, petition such and such time, result within such and such time. Now whole thing has been changed. And as a lawyer, I feel that election law might have to be changed drastically after the crisis is over. Because we talk of social distancing. And when you see during election, MLA, MP, hundreds of people are present outside the polling building. 10, 20 people are pending in the polling, present in the polling booth, all sitting side by side. Hundreds of people coming and going for vote. I think if the impact, adverse impact of corona continues, one law that will have to be amended drastically, maybe the election law. Then you can't afford the polling booths in the locality where all parties are having their tents, people are sitting there, coming, mixing and all that. You maybe ultimately have to resort for the online voting or to find some other way where the secrecy is also secured, but at the same time, you don't get a chance. So maybe that you will have to stop people coming to the poll, the parties, their agents, etc., etc., to the polling booths. Maybe they have to be ultimately prohibited not to go for canvassing, because if you go for canvassing, you come in touch with the person concerned. You hand over your papers to the voters. Social distancing gets violated. Whether there is a social distancing or you go for personal talk, personal contact. So I am of the view that after the crisis is over, ultimately we may have to go for the drastic changes in the election law. Pattern has to be changed. Procedure will have to be changed. Counting. Nowadays in the counting hall, there are 100, 200, 300, 400 people in a particular counting hall. Social distancing says you have to maintain a distance of two yards. So I'm suggesting this is a new point which will come ultimately. What changes have to be brought, how they have to be brought. And third thing, which I'm the last I would like to tell you, my friends, we are all in the profession of the legal profession, doing practice and acting laws. This law is very deep. This law deals with all the situations that can be visualized in the elections. And I told you earlier, I have been telling my all friends, if we develop a little bit habit of reading the sections and then applying them, seeing the law, number of judgments have now come on different aspects of the law. Even Justice Nijjar's judgment is there, Supreme Court says that if you do not give all the information about your past conduct, criminal cases, your property and all that, this might amount to undue influence. And on that account, your election can be set aside. Please start. Nowadays, we have got sufficient time sitting at our home. We can go through those judgments. We can do the provisions of law and we can go through the various other annexments, conduct of election rules. I'm not going in detail all those because then it takes very, very long time. But the last point which I'm making is this. Law is there. Interpretation of law is also there. They are all in our books, lying on our table, lying in the back. Everything is with us. The only thing is if we made a little effort to go through them, there is no problem. And in the courts, I have seen in a number of cases, law also matters. But the facts of each and every case are the most important thing. If we are fully prepared on the facts of the case, as a lawyer, I can say, we will not be facing as much problems as we can face otherwise also. These are the small things. In short, I have brought to your notice. If you want to ask me any question, any clarification, I know it's a technical subject, you are most welcome.
Sir, taking cue from you, we have opened the chat box, but we still ask that we will ask the members just to restrict the questions to the election law, number one, and they should maintain the decency. The question, they should not post anything which is not called for on this platform. If they have certain expressions which have to be expressed, it cannot be posted in any other group.
I have got one query from Bhupinder Gupta about the Maharashtra CM. Where is Mr. Bhupinder Gupta? Okay, no problem.
Nobody will be allowed to unmute it because of the past experience. They are posting the questions.
Okay.
So I can read Bhupinder Gupta's question.
Sir,
I can read the question for you so that
I have read it. There on my screen. See, he is talking about the CM of Maharashtra. As per the Constitution of India, any MLA, minister, chief minister has to become a member of either of the houses within 6 months from the date he takes oath. He took oath on 27th of November. And by 27th of May, he has to become a member of either the Maharashtra Vidhan Sabha or Maharashtra Vidhan Parishad. Now, only few days are left for becoming that. Now, the question is, if he doesn't become a member by that time, what will be the position? In case he is not able to become a member of either Maharashtra Vidhan Sabha, which he will not be because there is no election, or Maharashtra Vidhan Parishad, he will lose his chief ministership on 27th of May. Earlier, what some of the state governments used to do was give you oath for 6 months today. After the expiry of 6 months, he will resign. Then next day again, he will be given the oath and he will continue for 6 months more. And by this way, they could take 2 years, 3 years. But now Supreme Court has said that this 6 years term is applicable without becoming member of either house only once. Once you have completed your 6 months term, second time you cannot do it. So therefore, either he becomes a member of the Vidhan Parishad or Vidhan Sabha, because Maharashtra, there are two houses, assembly also and the Vidhan Parishad also. Haryana has one, Punjab has one, Himachal has only one assembly. Then he will be losing his membership. But now since the election commission has announced the elections for 21st of May, let us see what happens.
Thank you, sir. So I will read the questions for your convenience and we will go by serendipity. Whatever questions are done by the time lag, we will only do those questions. Mr. Lokesh Singhal, as we all know, he was a...
I know.
Once respondent has filed an application... So I will just read it for the common person. I know that you are able to read it, but the other person will not come to know that which what answer you are giving to which question. Once respondent has filed an application under Order 7, Rule 11, for rejection of election petition as it lacks material particulars, can the court direct the respondent to file written statement also while issuing the notice to the application for rejection?
See, the returned candidate has the discretion whether to file the written statement or not. He has that discretion. He can wait till the decision of the application of Order 7, Rule 11. He can file the written statement after the decision on that application also.
Sir, Saloni Gautam is a student. It is a personal take she wants. Is it a time to enable qualification criteria for the ministers in center and state? What is your take?
Yes, you see, law is ever changing. It's not stable. If you see, during the last 60 years, many amendments have been made. And I'll request you to go through the qualifications and disqualifications which are contained in Section 3 to Section 11B. Of the Representation of People Act 1951. Many people are not even aware of that. If you read all those qualifications and disqualifications, they are very comprehensive. But still, I am of the view that it all keeps on changing with the time. For example, now, earlier there was a clause that if a sitting member of parliament or MLA is disqualified for any criminal offense for more than 2 years, his membership will not come to an end so long as the case is pending in the higher court, maybe High Court or Supreme Court. Now, by way of judgments of the Supreme Court, then this was amended. It said, no, the moment you are disqualified and if the disqualification is more than 2 years, your membership of the assembly or parliament comes to an end immediately. And it was made applicable in the case of Shri Lalu Prakash Yadav, because after earlier it continued for a long time. And I am very happy that the students are taking a lot of interest in the adding qualifications for the MPs, MLAs and all that. You give your suggestions, we will discuss someday, but more could be the qualifications and disqualifications for that.
Sir, Rohini Raheja asks, the question related to disqualification is settled by whom? Election Commission or the courts or no. The Parliament?
Basically, the law is enacted by the Parliament. It is the Parliament which has to declare the law, decide the law. And Parliament enacted the Representation of People's Act 1951, which deals with the qualification, disqualification, etc. But by way of two or three judgments, Supreme Court has interpreted those qualification and disqualification, which has practically taken to amending the law or enacting a new law. But the basic rights vest with the Parliament to enact the law regarding qualification, disqualification of MPs, MLAs, etc.
So, Lokesh Vora, to which authority, order passed by the returning officer can be challenged.
The order passed by the returning officer is final. It can be challenged only by way of an election petition after the election is over. I will request you to go through the Constitution Bench judgment of the Supreme Court in Mahinder Singh Gill's case. 1978 Supreme Court Mahinder Singh Gill's case, Justice Krishna Iyer's very elaborate, very comprehensive judgment, which says the election process from the filing of the nomination till the declaration is one. The order of the returning officer is also a part of the election process. And election under Article 329B can be challenged only after the declaration of the result. So therefore, there is no remedy of filing any appeal representation against the order of the returning officer, even if it is illegal. The only remedy is to file an election petition after the election is over. You can start reading from 1952 Kunnu Swami's case until law, number of judgments have come on that point.
Sir, Advocate Rohit Sharma, if at the time of scrutiny a conviction judgment is brought to the notice of the returning officer, then whether his candidacy will be cancelled automatically or not?
See, if it is brought to the notice of the returning officer that this man is not qualified or he is convicted for more than 2 years, the returning officer is bound to reject his nomination papers because he is not qualified to contest election.
Sir, Amar Vivek, another lawyer from our High Court. Recording of the evidence in election petition filed in the High Court consumes a lot of time, contributing to the delay. Now, in view of the current times and also due to the delay in disposal of election petition, should not be a law enacted to record evidence through a court question by video conferencing?
See, these are the all good suggestions. They keep on coming. Earlier, we saw that evidence used to be recorded. Even the examination in chief have been doing election petitions for the last 40 years. The person will come in the witness box. He will come out with his statement, question, answer, then cross-examination. Then it was amended. You can file your examination in chief by way of affidavit. The affidavit system has come. These are all suggestions which always need consideration. The attempt should be made to decide the petition within reasonable time. Under Section 86 of the Representation of People Act, the High Court is supposed to dispose of the election petition within 6 months. Within 6 months. And I know, even in our High Court, I think still that petition is pending. The election petition against Captain Amrinder Singh relating perhaps to the election when? Not 17, not 15, not 16, not 10, not 9, not 8. 2002 assembly election. 17 years, 18 years back, this petition perhaps still is pending in our High Court for disposal.
Sir Siddharth Dave, probably I'll check it. He should be the designated senior from Delhi. Can you please explain the aspect of substantial compliance as enumerated in the case of TM Jacom and subsequent judgments, and if any defect is cured within the period of limitation, can we save the petition from dismissal order under Order 7, Rule 11 and under Section 86 of the Republic Act?
Yes, Siddharth Dave knows all those judgments very well. Now, after some time, earlier the law was very strict that the election petition supplied to the other side must be line to line, page to page, word to word chain. Now the Constitution Bench's judgment have come, 3-4 judgments have come, which says that if there is a substantial compliance, for example, you have supplied a copy of the election petition as filed in the High Court to the other side. There is a small mistake. You have just, instead of N, you have typed A. For example, in your name, Ram Lal, you have been able to type is Ran Lal. But the substantial compliance is there. You have got the copy. There is no material difference. Dates are the same. Material is the same. Allegations are the same. But there are small mistakes here and there. So the Constitution Benches have now gone to the extent saying that yes, if there is a substantial compliance, then it is sufficient compliance of the law. And I think now the trend is going towards that. Don't dismiss the election petition on such frivolous points at the initial stage. See to it if sufficient information has been given. And as the Supreme Court in one of the judgment has said, that if the other party has not been misled by those mistakes, then it is sufficient compliance.
So, Anil Soni asked, do you think that due to COVID High Court shutdown, whether the Limitation Act will be protected? I think that Supreme Court judgment of the order should protect it. But
I think this will be a very serious issue which will have to need consideration. In my view, it may not get extended because during this period, the 45 days limitation, if you come to the High Court and tell the concerned officer, registrar, because mentioning is there, emergency filing is also there. So this will be one argument that yes, you could have come and filed a petition. The other side will be saying, no, 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 the High Court was closed, I couldn't travel. So this issue ultimately will arise for the interpretation by the courts. And you know, how do the court interpret? It only is a matter of guess and imagination. And I tell you, election law is so technical. You will be surprised which example I am going to give. In Bihar, somebody filed a petition on the ground of recounting. High Court did the recounting, declared the candidate elected by 25 votes. The person whose election was set aside came to the Supreme Court and challenged that order. The other man said that, look here, counting has been done. I am getting 25 votes more than him. Supreme Court set aside the order of the High Court. He said that you could not do recounting because the basic facts were not pleaded in the election petition. So, must be looking very surprising to you, to me also when I read it for the first time. Supreme Court said, since the petitioner has not complied with the mandatory provision of law, so even if in the recounting he is getting more votes than the returned candidate, he cannot be declared elected. It's a reported judgment 93. It may be extended, because if the polling has been deferred, then how can you stop the people from filing the election petition after the corona is over?
Nikunj Dhawan asked, can you discuss certain aspects of the election petition filed against the PM?
See, the election petition against the Prime Minister this time was filed by a person who was dismissed from the military. Yes. BSF. As a matter of fact, under Section 33, if you are a dismissed employee, then you have to attach a certificate issued by the Election Commission of India that you have not been dismissed either on the allegation of corruption or on the allegation of disloyalty to the state. If you do not file this affidavit, you are not qualified to contest election. This man did not file that affidavit with him. And similar judgment, so therefore, his nomination had been rightly rejected. This point is covered by many judgments of the Constitutional Bench in the case of Gyani Jaisingh, the President of India, in the case of other honorable presidents who held the position. Supreme Court's Constitution Bench has already said in a number of judgments that if you do not file your nomination paper validly, if you do not attach the certificates which make you eligible to contest election, then your nomination is rightly rejected. And if the nomination is rightly rejected, then under Section 100, the election petition can be filed by a candidate only if his nomination has been illegally rejected, meaning thereby you are qualified to contest election, but your nomination has been rejected. But if it has been legally rejected, legally means you are not qualified, then there is no ground for filing the election petition.
So, Advocate Digvijay, whether any person who is a municipal corporation elected candidate can still he be elect as an MLA and hold the post together?
No. See, if you are a member of the municipal corporation and you contest the election of an MLA, you can contest the election of MLA, you can become an MLA. But the post of the president, etc., in the council, etc., is concerned, you can't contest that. And now, so far as the members of two houses are concerned, where the elections are held simultaneously, MLA, MP, etc., etc., there is a complete prohibition that you cannot hold two positions. But in the case of municipal commissioner, he can get elected also and continue to be both. But he can't hold any office in the municipal committee.
Sir, Tejeshwar Singh Solar, he poses the question, can election petition filed in the High Court be withdrawn, especially when that person who had filed the election petition later on joins the same party?
The election petition cannot be withdrawn in the High Court by the petitioner. In case he wants to withdraw the election petition, he has to move an application. The High Court will issue a journal notice to the public at large, and any voter of that constituency could come and say, I want to continue this petition. He cannot withdraw the election petition. Therefore, what people do is, I know in one case from Amritsar also, where the election petition was filed against the then MP who later on joined Congress. The petitioner was also a member of the same party later on he became a minister also. So what people do is, then they don't withdraw the election petition. Lawyers know how to come out of the difficult situation. Then they don't appear when the case is called. And then ultimately, for non-prosecution, it is dismissed. But strictly as per law, you cannot withdraw the election petition without, number one, the permission of the court. Secondly, without issuing notice to the public at large. And third, when the notice is issued, any voter, any eligible person can come and say, now I want to continue with this election petition, implead me as a petitioner.
Amarjeet Virk, in Rajya Sabha election, vote can be voted by only prescribed pen. How it is determined?
Yes. See, this issue arose in number of states. Under the election law, not only in the Rajya Sabha elections, wherever any voter goes to cast his vote, the ink and pen is prescribed by the returning officer. This is to ensure the security and, not security, safety and secrecy of the vote. I give an example. You have to mark your vote by pen. Okay. If same pen is not given to all the persons, 100 MLAs have to vote, they are given the same pen which is kept there, then count the votes, you will not be able to find out as to this mark has been put by which MLA. But if you don't prescribe that particular pen which is same for everybody, somebody manages an MLA, look here, I'll give you so much amount, you vote for me, you vote with a blue pen. So he marks his presence with blue pen. When the counting takes place, you can tell that he has a ballot with a blue pen or a green pen or a red pen. Secrecy will be violated. So therefore, to maintain the secrecy, it has been prescribed under law. It is here also, it's of MLAs also, when there was a stamp used to be put on the ballot paper, it has to be with the same pen. Even now in the case of elections to the mayor of the municipal corporation, and all where, wherever you have to mark, then the mark has to be, the instrument has to be supplied by the returning officer, which is same for everybody. So the secrecy is not valid.
Sir, Satyavan, the purpose of filing election petition is defeated when it is not decided before the next election. Can there be some suggestions where it could be made down time bound so that at least the result is declared prior in time?
This is already getting the attention of legal experts. We in the election commission also, when I was a member, we examined that issue. Two, three suggestions are coming. One is that instead of vesting the jurisdiction of deciding the election petition, which is a luxurious litigation, which takes a lot of time of the court, some people have suggested, let there be the tribunals consisting of the retired judges of the Supreme Court or the High Court sitting at one place, having the exclusive jurisdiction of deciding the election petitions. It may take less time, it may be expedited. These are the suggestions which are coming. But then people point out the experience of the tribunals like KIAT, AFT, etc., that wherever the tribunals were created, constituted, so things have not improved to that extent. Trying our best, if the all lawyers and the judge cooperate, it can be decided in time. But as yet, there is no consensus on the measures to be taken for that.
Karambi Nalwa, once the period of 45 days is over and an application for rejection of EP is filed on ground of petition not having material facts and particulars of any corrupt practice, can the petitioner be allowed to amend his petition?
See, let's be clear about two things. Section 86 permits the amendment of the election petition only to the extent that you can provide material particulars, not the real facts. Not the material facts. If the material particulars are missing, then you can provide them with the permission of the court. Once the election petition is dismissed under Section 86, under saying it lacks in material facts, then the only remedy available is to go to Supreme Court to file an appeal, especially under Section 116, and then Supreme Court will examine whether the facts were there or not. If Supreme Court permits, says no, the facts were there, High Court has wrongly dismissed, it will remand back. It has been done in a number of cases, even this Captain Amarinder Singh's case. The High Court has dismissed the election petition on this ground, but then Supreme Court remanded it back. No, it contains material facts. But the only remedy is to file an appeal, civil appeal, under Section 116 of the RP Act.
Siddharth Dave has clarified that he's from Gujarat, because I know one Siddharth Dave is from Delhi. He has clarified. Isha Agarwal.
Delhi man is Dushyant Dave, not Siddharth Dave.
Siddharth Dave is, there is someone, Siddharth Dave also, he's also joining one of our platforms. So when and where can the electoral roll be challenged, Isha Agarwal?
See, there is a complete procedure prescribed under the 1950 Act, Representation of People Act 1950. First, very interesting thing there also. For being eligible to be enrolled as a voter, you have to be 18 years of age and on the 1st January of that year. So in 2020, if I want to be enrolled as a voter, I must be 18 years of age on 1st of January 2020. Meaning thereby that this 18 years term get extended by 3 months, 4 months, 6 months, 5 months, 7 months. Sometime even if, suppose you are born on 30th of December. So you will be enrolled practically when you are 19 years of age. But that is the law. You have to follow that. First, it is expected from the staff of the Election Commission of India to visit door-to-door households, revision, preparation of the electoral rolls. Then they publish a draft. It is published, made public. Then they invite objections to that. For example, your vote has not been included. You can apply that, look here, I am a voter. I was a voter, I am residing here, please include my name. If somebody has been wrongly included, which we call as bogus list, object to that, that these are not persons who are living here. Then those objections are decided. Against those objections, you can appeal to the next higher authority. And against that rejection, if you go to the chief electoral officer, you can challenge that by way of writ petition to the High Court. That my objections have not been considered. But you cannot simply sit or come to the court and say, look here, I am a voter, I have not been enrolled as a voter. Nobody will listen to you. You have to approach the concerned authority for including your name. And there is a form called as 6A. Form 6A. It is a form which is available all the 24 hours and all the 12 months. If you are not enrolled as a voter, fill that form to the electoral officer, he will enroll you as a voter. If you somebody has been wrongly included, give that form, he will be deleted after giving notice to the person. But election petition cannot challenge the entry in the electoral rolls.
Since we are also live on the Facebook, there's one question from the Facebook Live. Is the recommendation of the cabinet binding on the governor in relation to a nomination to the legislative council when CM is the head of the cabinet and CM has to be nominated? Satya Ranjan Savan from Delhi High Court.
In my view, it is not binding. You see, there are certain acts which governor is bound under Article 64 to act as per the aid and advice of the Council of Ministers. But for example, he acts as the chancellor. In many states, governors are the chancellors. And in case he has to appoint a vice chancellor, then he is not acting as a governor. He is acting as the chancellor of the concerned university. Court says in that situation, he can take you. For example, he has to garden to some people who are convicted. Now, the judgments have come that, look here, governor is not bound by the advice of the Council of Ministers. He can go by his own advice. In my view, the governor in the matter of the nomination to the council, in my purview, so far as I'm concerned, authority to my budget, the governor is not bound to accept the recommendation of the Council of Ministers because it is a question of the constitution of the legislative council. He has to send people who are qualified, who according to him are fit to be members of the house. But still, this issue, I thought will go to the High Court. But since now the elections have been announced on May 21, somebody may not go to the court of law. Let's see what happens in future.
Sir, Dinesh Bhardwaj, can Election Commission suo motu take action against any misconduct on account of false statement of the candidate?
See, suo motu, it cannot take action, but in one or two judgments from Maharashtra, it has come. Early law was that you can challenge the election against any candidate that you are doing this and that only by way of an election petition. But now with the coming of the code of conduct, moral code of conduct, now this has come that action can be taken, but not to the extent that it will ultimately adversely affect the provisions of law. Now after the code of conduct, because it is now enforceable. In Harbans Lal Jalal's case, our own I have said that the moral code of conduct is enforceable. So if you violate those conditions, election commission can take notice, but before take action, before taking election commission is to give notice to the concerned person. This is the allegation against you. This is the law you have violated, especially the Model Code of Conduct. Secondly, the election commission can enforce the law before Mr. the fellow.
Hello.
That the provisions of law are implemented by each and every candidate, and if you violate the law, then action can be taken against you.
So, Vijayveer, whereas there is a provision of right to vote for a government employee, why there is no provision for contesting elections or becoming an office bearer of a political party without resigning the government post? What is your take on that?
See, the laws are to be laid down by the Parliament of India. There is a, the Parliament feels that no, they should not be eligible to contest election. They are not. Tomorrow, some government might come, some Parliament might come, which say, no, they are eligible. Whether you are eligible or not, what should be the qualification or disqualifications, they are decided by the Parliament. In India, we move to the left. That is the law. In America, it is to the right, because they think the move towards is the best choice, best way, best law. Ultimately, things have to be done as prescribed by the Parliament. You have your own opinion. Others may have their own opinion. Ultimately, it is the law which has to be laid down by the Parliament.
Shumendu Mukherjee, can a voter be eligible to vote for two places holding two voter I cards?
No. As per Section 30-31 of the Representation of People Act 1950, a person can vote only at one place in the election, maybe in the same constituency, maybe in different constituencies. And if you vote at two places, your vote at both the places is void. Void. You can't vote more than once.
Rohit Sharma asked, other than PA and PS, a candidate can take assistance of a government employee during elections? Which government employee can take?
See, there are seven conditions laid down in Section 123 that may not be a gazetted officer, judges, military officer, and all this. These are the seven conditions laid down under Section 123. Seven. Categories are mentioned. I'll just read you that also. 123, seven. These are seven categories. I'll just read it. Just 123 subsection 7. Gazetted officers, stipendary judges and magistrates, members of the armed forces of the union, members of the police force, excise officers, revenue officers, and any such other officer may be prescribed by the government. So these are the six, seven categories which are totally prohibited, whose vote you cannot take during the elections. 123.7.
Thank you for the insights. Sudhir Nar, how can a person vote if he is if he is at high sea on a naval vessel or a ship?
See, if you are an employee, then before the actual date of polling, the employees are given an option that if you are on duty on that day, you can apply for the postal ballot. So the concerned returning officer will issue a postal ballot, which has to be marked and which has to be sent in time. But if you have not applied for the postal ballot, then whether you are in vessel or you are in Delhi or Mumbai or Chandigarh, wherever you are supposed to just go to the polling booth and cast your vote. There is no other way of casting your vote. Of course, now NRIs, military people, they are making certain provisions. But if you are in service, you can apply for postal ballot well in time.
Sir, Alankit Bhardwaj, you might be knowing, he is working with Namit Kumar, another advocate from the High Court. Alankrit asks, vote boxes are opened area-wise due to which the elected candidate knows which area has not voted for him and becomes a bias to that particular area. How can we stop this mallet and malafice?
See, ordinarily, people who are elected as MLAs or MPs, which is a constitutional post, very high responsible post in the country, they are supposed not to go these small things. Whether somebody has voted for you or have not voted for you, after you are declared elected to that office, this should not be the consideration for you. But still, we are all human beings. Everybody is a human being. Sometimes you get, these people do not vote for me, did not vote for me, they did not support me in the elections. Now, a move is there, which is at a very initial stage, that nowadays you are voting at the voting machines, and from polling booth wise, you come to know which area has voted for whom. Not at a very serious stage, but people are suggesting that with the advancement of the technology, opening the EVM means after a particular date in a hall, booth wise, can you connect them? Some central agency of the returning officer where the representatives of the people are also coming. So instead of opening it, it can be jointly counted before the returning officer and the result declared. But this will be tooth and nail opposed by the parties, by the dates also, because then you don't come to know, you will many people will level the allegation that look here, some wrong thing has been done, some bungling here. But this is the effect of the law. Till now, nobody has been able to find a solution to that.
Siddharth, Dave again poses a question. If any election agent commits a misconduct by trying to snatch a ballot paper or any other misconduct during the election process, can any action be taken against him?
In election law, all actions of the election agent, duly authorized election agent, are taken to be the actions of the returned candidate. And person with the consent of the candidate are the actions of the candidate. The candidate can be held liable for all the actions which are against the law of the election agent or any other person authorized by the candidate. So ultimately, it is the candidate who is responsible for all those acts.
Sir, Dr. Ashok Makkar is a professor and teaches law. He poses a question, university teachers fight elections after taking leave from university. What is your take, whether it could be should be allowed or not?
See, it all depends upon the particular situation in the university. Because they are basically employees of the university, which is a autonomous institution. They are not disqualified to contest election. In Punjab University, I remember Mr. D.N. Sharma was elected from Gurdaspur on the Congress I ticket. Dr. Ram Prakash was elected as an MLA. Professor Vishwanath Tiwari was nominated. From Delhi University also, I think Om Prakash Kohli was the member of the Rajya Sabha elected there. This is not a prohibition so far as the election law is concerned. This is not a, you are qualified, but just to maintain discipline so that the university knows it. University knows why, who is going to contest election. If you are going to contest election, you may leave that post also. It's a full-time job, MP, MLA. You may not. There are some people, some political leaders who inspired elected to legislatures, did not resign their job in the university and continue teaching there. So therefore, it is only a disciplinary measure. And again, professor, you know it very well. The laws are the laws laid down by the society, by the parliament. There was a time when people used to own 200 acres of land, 300 acres of land, 150 acres of land. Land reforms came, the case, land reforms came. Now you can't have more than 30 acres of land. Both have their own arguments. Law says, laws are the laws. Rights are rights, which are recognized by the procedure prescribed by particular time.
Manish Bali. So, is it audible? Hello. Sir. Manish Bali. Your guidance is required on a petition filed before the speaker of a Lok Sabha or a legislative assembly. What is the difference between such petitions filed before them?
Since it was not a topic of today's discussion, I have not dealt with that. Those are the petitions which are filed by anti-defection law. There is a 10th schedule to the Constitution of India, which deals with those MLAs who leave their party after they are elected on the ticket of one party. If I may tell you shortly, 10th schedule, paragraph 2 of the Constitution of India, if you are elected on the ticket of any political party, you have to remain with that party. If you are elected as an MLA, as an independent candidate, you have to remain as an independent. So the person, member of the political party, can't leave that party. and independent cannot join any political party. Status quo as on the date of election has to be maintained. And if there is any dispute as to whether somebody has violated the whip, somebody has left the party on whose ticket he was elected, or somebody was elected as an independent, he has joined a political party, as per para 6 of the 10 schedule, this dispute goes to the speaker. And it is the speaker who decides. And there have been number of examples in this country where speakers have, I don't want to use very hard words for the speaker, abuse this power to the maximum possible extent. Maximum possible extent. And favoring the ruling party on whose ticket they were elected as the speaker. So now the trend is coming that Supreme Court, in the case of Manipur, gave a direction to the speaker of that assembly to decide education petition within 3 months. In the case of Haryana, Kuldeep Bishnoi's case, the Supreme Court directed the speaker to decide petition within 3 months. But by the time that judgment gave, almost 5 years term over, and ultimately they were disqualified by Justice Karnan, all those five MLAs who had defected from Haryana Janhit Congress to Congress. But it took a lot of time. But now the trend is towards directing the speakers to take the decision at an early date, not to delay beyond a particular time. But they are all the petitions under the anti-defection law. I will deal with that on some other day because it's a full subject which needs consideration.
We are so happy that you have seated before we could ask that you would come for a second session. That is a wonderful experience. Shikha Yadav, what are the restrictions for a candidate with 3 children to contest the elections for a corporation or Gram Panchayat? When he has given 1 child for adoption or 1 child had expired before the election, can he or she still contest or not?
See, there is no such provision so far as the MLCs, Rajya Sabha, MLCs are concerned. There is no such provision in the central law. The provisions which have been made in certain states, for example, Haryana has also made it. You can't have more than a particular number of children. And when they enacted the law, they gave 1 year gap also, so that if there is any child in the process, that may not disqualify the parents. You can take cautionary measures within time. So these are the provisions in the state acts, which are governed by the state election commission. I told you earlier in the very beginning, election to Gram Panchayat, Municipal Committee, Panchayat Samiti, Municipal Corporation, Jila Parishad, etc., they are conducted by the state election commission. So these are the provisions there. There's no such provision for MLA, MP. As yet, I can say.
So, what action can be taken against a person who fights election under one party and later on joins other party?
Yes. Under 10th schedule, para 2A, it says two things. If an MLA elected on the ticket of one political party leaves that party, disqualified from being member of the house. Or if he abstains or votes against the whip issued by the political party, he is disqualified from the membership of the house. But some people confuse this disqualification with disqualification under the RPA Act. This disqualification is only that his membership comes to an end. In the by-election, he can again contest and can be re-elected. So therefore, if you leave the party, you violate the anti-defection law. There are certain conditions that whether the party has merged. I said it is a separate full topic, full subject where a lot of discussion is needed. So he will go his membership.
Siddharth Dave poses a question beyond the this thing, what is on the platform, but everybody wants to know. He says that Mr. Jain has so much work, like we initially asked, like you are a successful lawyer, successful politician, successful academician, successful family person. What is the secret of energy? How come you are so vibrant and energetic?
All grace of God and the best wishes of the people like you and all that, and full pressure of the family. My son, Dheeraj Jain, it is he who is preparing for the cases. My family gives me all support and I have to go. I said, perhaps during 68 years of life, this may be the only time.
Probably you will have come come closer to the mic. Again, there is a cracking of the voice.
I think in my life, this is perhaps the first time when for full 1.5 months, I had to stay home. Otherwise, in a month, 10, 15 days, I'm always out of house and out of opportunity. Or second time was in 7, when emergency was imposed, I was 23 years of age and I was in Budail jail. One of the people, Mr. Jitendra Veer Gupta, who was in the same barrack, I was there. Mr. Dilip Chand Gupta, Mr. M.R. Lakhan Pal, Kaushal Chand Goel, we were all in the same barrack. Later on, he became the Chief Justice of the Punjab and Haryana High Court, Justice J.V. Gupta. There was one prisoner with us, Mr. Satpal Gupta. He became the IS officer from emergency. So this is the only time when I have spent so much time with the full cooperation of the family. My son Dheeraj also, my granddaughters, Adhya and the small baby, they, whenever I come house, they make me happy. The moment I come there, Baba, Baba, karke wo nikal jate. So then, secondly, it's all grace of God. Kaun anak sab teri badhiyai, koi non hai.
So we can say that the entire Dheeraj comes from the name of the Dheeraj itself from your family. We are about to close and thank you for a wonderful session. We couldn't have called for anything better. As we say, Gagar mein Sagar, the entire gamut of election law is not easy to be summed up. It could have only been summed up by a person who is well versed with the facts, law on his steps. Invariably, anybody who is asked the question off the cuff is very difficult to handle. So we would also like to tell that we are live on Facebook, as well as Mr. Sapanthir is also coordinating in these affairs. He has also gone live on his Facebook. So I would ask Mr. Puneet Jindal, who is a senior member of the bar from Punjab and Haryana High Court, you would be knowing him, to propose a formal vote of thanks.
Where is he? He was not seen.
Sir, he is there. He was earlier watching on the Facebook live. He thought that it's better to. I said that we are trying it for the first time. Puneet, you handle and give us the feedback.
When he joined practice, he had come to my chamber.
Yes, actually, I was saying so, and in fact, I got this good opportunity to thank. And in fact, I started my profession with Jain Saab only. I was way back 32 years back in 1987. I joined chambers of Satyapal Jain Saab. Now at that time, Jain Saab was not. Jain Saab was dealing a lot of work on the municipal committee side. Slowly, Jain Saab had developed other fields, including election laws. And now everyone sees him. We are so grateful that we have been guided by you, and especially for all members of this Beyond Law. We, from the bottom of our heart, we thank Satyapal Jain Saab from the core of our heart, and grateful for sparing time for us. And giving us, enlightening us on the election laws. Basically, election laws it's only with a lot of practice and experience that the election law field, especially for MLAs and MPs, one can practice. But with the guidance of Jain Saab, even youngster can venture out now in the election petition and filing of and practicing election laws. So we are, thank you. We thank you for your contribution, you, for your advice, for your telling us, giving us all the light, showing all the aspects of the election laws and nuances. Thank you very much, sir.
Can I ask Dheeraj Jain to come forward, because he has been the backbone we have been tying up since the day we took the your appointment. Dheeraj has been the backbone. Dheeraj, can you come on the platform?
Yes, sir. Dheeraj is here.
Since Mr. Jain has already told that Dheeraj is the background of his entire Dheeraj in his family. So Dheeraj, just two words. How does your father help you as a mentor, in the profession, in the family, and guiding you in this profession? The key for your success.
Thank you, Dheeraj. Thank you, Dheeraj. Thank you, Dheeraj.
Dheeraj, can you hear me?
You will have to unmute him.
Dheeraj Jain, unmute. Dheeraj? Yes. Dheeraj, you have been unmuted. Dheeraj, or you can come towards Mr. Jain's side for a minute.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes, it's perfect. Yes.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, perfect, perfect. Dheeraj, we can hear you.
Yes, sir. There's so much to learn, so much to watch, and so much to do with sir. So you get to know, sir, not only the legal aspects or all aspects, aspects of working, aspects how to manage time.
Dheeraj, the voice is cracking. You will have to come towards Mr. Jansai.
Come here.
Is it better, sir?
Yes, perfect.
Yes, sir. Sir, there's so much to learn. There's so much to watch and so much to inculcate in your day-to-day working. The legal aspects, the other aspects, the day-to-day working.
Dheeraj?
Even during the lockdown, I have seen my father get ready every day at 9 o'clock and sit in his office. So this kind of things that you get to learn from, you get to see, you get to watch, and you get to inculcate even not only the legal aspects, but other for the entire working that you can do.
It's quite pleasing and heartening that once you are closer to him, still you have imbibed all those good things. Otherwise, it is normally said that closer to church, further from God. But once you have a father who is a fatherly figure and is considered to be God by many people who have followed him, who has helped him during his political career, professional career. So still being nearer to the church and still you are quite close to God. That's a fantastic job. And can we ask Mr. Jain for a minute, Dheeraj, or he has left it?
Yes.
Thank you once again for all the participants who have joined us. It was a wonderful session. Keep following us on the Facebook and the Instagram or the WhatsApp group for the latest updates. And thank you, sir. We would love you.
Anytime.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful session, Beyond Law, CLC, and ULS, Punjabi University, Chandigarh.